have done for me. You've set me free. My heart is now your home. I'll never be alone. What you've done for me.
They seem to get you down. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Yes, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father God. Amen. Yes, Lord, thank you. Like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, Thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul, it is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul. The day when my faith shall be sight, the clouds be rolled back as a scroll, the trump shall resound, and the Lord shall descend. Even so, it is well with my soul, it is well with my soul, it is well. It is well with my soul.
pray. Father, as we open your holy word, I ask that you would cleanse me of all unrighteousness. Fill my life with your Holy Spirit's presence and power. Speak to me, through me, and for me. I promise you, Lord, I'll always give you the honor, the glory, and the praise. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen. If you have your Bibles with you, the printed kind or the electronic kind, turn with me to the book of Revelation, chapter 12, verse 12. The Bible says, "Therefore rejoice, ye heavens, and ye that dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea, for the devil is come down unto you, having great wrath, because he knoweth that he hath but a short time." May God add a blessing to the reading of his word. It was the morning of September 9th, and a rare event was about to take place in the annals of the U.S. Army. All the soldiers on the barracks were assembled, and a private by the name of William Scott was brought out of his cell. He was placed against a wall, guns about to be drawn, for you see, that day, those soldiers were about to witness the execution of one of their own. The firing squad took its position. The death sentence was read, when suddenly, without skipping a beat, another document was produced. It read that upon review of the case, Private William Scott had been granted a pardon by none other than the President of the United States. Church, when I read of this soldier's plight, I asked, what offense was Private Scott guilty of, and what crime had he committed? I wanted to find out what misdeed had he done to warrant a court-martial and such a sentence, to die from a volley of bullets from his fellow soldiers. Well, as I dug further, I found out what his offense was. He had violated Article 113 of military law. And this article of military law stated that sleeping on duty during wartime was punishable by death. Now, the year this happened was 1861. And the man who pardoned this sleeping sentinel, as he later came to be called, was President Abraham Lincoln. Now, friends, you better believe that many soldiers today are grateful that the death penalty for sleeping on duty has disappeared from the enforced military code of modern armies. But church, this has not changed the fact that throughout history, the duty and obligation of a soldier on guard duty has always been and will always be a serious one. Because a soldier sleeping on guard duty can result in great tragedy and loss of life. And just like with Abraham Lincoln, the historical files of military archives around the world are replete with similar stories of grace and compassion shown to watchmen who fell asleep on duty. The story is told about one evening when the Emperor Napoleon found one of his sentinels, soldiers, asleep. And what Napoleon did next stunned his army. He lifted the soldier's gun, placed it on his shoulders, and stood guard for him for a couple of hours until that poor soldier was able to finish his involuntary nap. Church, early in my ministry, it became clear to me that one of the essential duties to which a pastor is called is to the post of what the Bible calls a watchman. And in ancient days, it was the duty of the watchman to patrol the walls of the city. His responsibility was twofold: to watch and to warn. To watch and to warn. To sound the alarm in case of threat or danger. Now, church, to be a watchman was serious work, because the fortunes and lives of an entire nation were placed in his keeping. A faithful watchman couldn't afford to be distracted. He had to be awake when others were sleeping. He had to remain alert and vigilant to protect the vulnerable and the innocent. His job was not to run out and meet the enemy. His job was to watch and warn, to give the trumpet a certain sound. And like it was centuries ago, being a watchman in God's army, today it is a serious obligation, even a grave one. The priests in Nehemiah's day were the watchmen on the walls of Zion, the priests. And they too had to watch and warn. And from early in my ministry, I don't know why, but I've always seen the role of watchmen as one of the key duties and responsibilities of a pastor. I've stood in this pulpit for over 2 decades. I've been watching and warning. And I've always seen being a watchman as an essential burden to which a pastor is called. Well, in the Bible, when God showed Isaiah in vision, the nations of Philistia, Moab, Damascus, Ethiopia, Egypt, and Arabia, to all of these nations, Isaiah delivered a prophecy. But to Judah, to Duma in the highlands, look at what the word of God said, Isaiah 21, verse 6. This is what the Lord says to me: go post a lookout and have him report what he sees. That's the responsibility of a pastor and minister, to look out and report on what he sees. And then verse 11, a prophecy against Duma. Someone calls to me from Seir: watchman, what is left of the night? Watchman, what is left of the night? The watchman replies, morning is coming, but also the night. And then in Ezekiel chapter 3, in the King James Version, God says to the prophet, son of man, I have made thee a watchman unto the house of Israel. But if the watchman see the sword come and blow not, does not blow the trumpet, and the people are not warned, if the sword come and take any person from among them, he is taken away in his iniquity. But his blood will I require at the watchman's hand. Church, God expects his watchman to always give the trumpet a clear and certain sound of warning, and God makes it clear. He will hold watchmen accountable if they sleep on duty. I remember reading a story of how the detective Sherlock Holmes cracked a mysterious case of a stolen horse named Silver Blaze. And the clue that led Detective Holmes to solve the case was that the dog in the stable yard did not bark. And that meant to Sherlock Holmes that the theft had to have been an inside job. The dog didn't bark because whoever stole the horse was already known by the dog. And that's why the dog didn't bark and no warning came. I want you to know, church, the Bible tells us that when we preachers don't sound a warning to lost men and women, that God says that we preachers are like dogs who don't bark when danger approaches. You thought this idea of a dog who wouldn't bark was something written by Arthur Doyle and the author of Sherlock Holmes. Oh no, this is from Scripture. You want to see what I'm talking about? Isaiah chapter 56. Look at what God says. Israel's watchmen are blind. They all lack knowledge. They are all... dogs who don't bark. Mute dogs. They cannot bark. They lie around and dream. And they love to sleep. Oh, but today I want you to see Isaiah standing high on a ridge between Judah and Duma. I want you to see Isaiah as he stands there as a spiritual watchman. He's enveloped in the dark of night. He's looking for threats and danger. And as Isaiah stands there in vision, he hears a voice coming out of Duma. It cries out, "Watchmen! What of the night? Watchmen, what is left of the night? Watchmen, how much longer do you see any light, any sign of the dawn? Watchmen, how long before the breaking of the day?" And this morning I came to you to speak to you, my church family. But today, I'm speaking to you as a watchman. One who is called to answer the question, what of the night? How much longer do we have to endure this darkness? First, let me say, I don't know if you've been living under a rock, but this week has been one of the most momentous weeks in American history. We have never seen a week like this one. And there's no doubt in my mind we are in for a rough ride ahead. And then there are those who I call, listen to this now, eschatology storm chasers. You got to listen to me now. You know, those people who seek to identify details of prophecy in every calamity. I call them eschatological storm chasers. They're looking for prophecy being fulfilled. They try to fit every little piece of history into the tapestry of God's great prophetic plan. And these last day events, storm chasers, they develop a kind of DPD syndrome. Pastor, what you talking about, DPD syndrome? A denominational personality disorder. You know, one that is completely alien to the loving character of Christ. I got to tell you, whenever I preach on prophecy and last day events, some of the craziest people come out of the woodwork. And I tell them all the time, what does it matter if you know the details of prophecy if in your character you're not prepared for the fulfillment of the prophecy? No wonder Jesus said in Matthew 7:21, not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name have cast out devils, done wonderful works? And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that worketh iniquity. Church, it is one thing to know Christ's teachings. It is another to resemble, reflect, and reveal his character. What many don't understand is that it is not the role of the watchman to dissect every social disturbance. The watchman is not there to tell you the prophetic significance of everything Fox News says or CNN says and make it fit into the tapestry of prophetic significance. No, we need to focus on the spiritual conflicts and not on the political conflicts that are raging in our society. Because if you chase every political conflict, you will soon see that political conflicts are nothing but a diversionary tactic of the enemy. And so today I speak as one called to watch and warn. Watchmen, what of the night? I say to you today, like Isaiah, make no mistake, it's dark out there. Watchmen, what of the night? A spiritual darkness, an ethical darkness, a moral darkness has descended upon our nation and our world. Isaiah 60 verse 2 says, it is a thick darkness that has come over the people. And not only is it dark in the world, it's getting dark in the church too. The world does not see in the church the light of God's character shining from his people throughout the earth. Many years ago, a man was killed at a railroad crossing one summer evening in 1891. His relatives sued the railroad, claiming negligence on the part of the watchman. Well, during the trial, the watchman was called to the witness stand. The prosecuting attorney asked him several questions. Sir, sir, were you on duty at the crossing at the time of the accident? The watchman said, yes, sir, I was on duty. He said, sir, did you have a lantern to warn the train was coming? Yes, sir, I did. Sir, did you wave your lantern in warning? Yes, sir, several times. Well, because of the answers of the watchman, the railroad was able to win its case. And days later, one of the officers of the railroad went to see the watchman to thank him for giving evidence in favor of the railroad that helped the railroad win the case. The officer asked the man, sir, were you nervous during the questioning at the trial? The watchman replied, oh, yes. He said, I feared every moment that lawyer would ask me, was your lantern lit? He said, because you see, sir, I was waving it, but my lantern was dark. What am I here to tell you? It doesn't mean a thing if in the church you're going through the motions of waving your lantern. If your lantern isn't lit, if the light of Christ's character is not shining in your lantern, no light will penetrate the pall of darkness that has settled over the earth. So church today, if you ask this watchman, if you ask me what of the night, I will tell you, can I tell you what I see? Here is what I see. What I see is that we are sitting right in the middle of Revelation 12:12. The book of Revelation is not linear. I'm telling you conceptually. We are sitting in the middle of Revelation 12:12. That's where we are in Bible prophecy. We are right in that Revelation 12:12. And remember what it says. Therefore rejoice, you heavens, and you who dwell in them. But what? Woe to the earth and the sea, because the devil has come down to you. He is filled with fury or seething anger because he knows that his time, that's where we are. He knoweth that he has but a what? Come on now. Well, as one who is called to watch and warn, I'm proclaiming to you with certainty this day, we are in the heart of Revelation 12:12. And there are three things the scripture is telling us in that verse. First is this: the devil knows he is running out of time. He knoweth that he hath, but the Bible says, or what? And in this scripture, God is also letting us know that we too, not just him, we too are running out of time. Now, I know that for the world, time is short, but the truth is that in our personal lives, for each and every one of us, time is short. Anybody here know what I'm talking about? For each of us, time is not a renewable resource. Once you use it, it's gone forever. Once you lose it, it's gone forever. You can't get it back. When I look at those old black and white pictures of myself and my family, I say to myself, where has the time gone? It reminds me of the guy who went to see his doctor for his annual checkup. He received a phone call a couple of days later from his doctor. The doctor said, I'm afraid I've got some bad news for you. What's the bad news? Asked the man. Well, said the doctor, you only have 48 hours to live. That's awful, said the man. Yeah, the doctor said, but I'm afraid I have even worse news than that. What, said the man, what in the world could be worse than what you've just told me? Well, said the doctor, I've been trying to reach you since yesterday. The Bible teaches us time. Come on, are you with me? Time is running out for us. That's why in Psalm 90:12 it says, teach us, Lord, to number our days that we may gain a heart of wisdom. You know, this past week I actually pulled out my phone, looked up the definition of elderly, and I was shocked. Did you know that anybody over 65 is considered elderly in this country? I don't care what they say. I can't see myself as, sometimes I may walk like it, but I don't see myself as elderly. But then I started doing the math. And so far, I'm at 68 years and 7 months, which means I've lived 25,050 days, 601,000 hours, 36 million seconds, 3,578 Sabbaths. So if that isn't elderly, I don't know what is. But what God is saying to me and to you is that time. In my life, I've had some awesome days, but even your awesome days run out. That's why, church, every day, you ought to get up and say to yourself, this is the day that the Lord has made. And I don't know about you, but I will rejoice and be glad in it. Did you know that next to life, time is your greatest treasure? And check this out, time is predicated on life. The time God gives you is a gift from him who is the servant of God says, in him is life, original, unborrowed, and underived. And if you don't have life, you don't have time. So believe me, you can have money, but if life has not blessed you with time, you can't spend your money. Money is worthless if you don't have the time that life blesses. Come on, somebody's listening to me today. So even though time is running out, never take time for granted. Time is a gift from God. Proverbs 27:1, do not boast about tomorrow, for you do not know what a day may bring forth. Always thank God for the time you have. Have you ever heard people say, I wish I had more hours in the day? Think of it, each day you live. Check this out. God put this in. Each day you live, you have the same amount of hours as Bill Gates, Elon Musk, and Jeff Bezos. They don't have any more time in their day than you have in yours. They get the same hours. Some years ago, the advertising firm of J. Walter Thompson in Chicago, they put out an advertising campaign, and in large type, it said, you have 24 hours to live. And in small print, it said, today, that is. What am I telling you? Bill Gates, Elon Musk, Jeff Bezos, with all their money, they have the same 24 hours to live as you do. And guess what? With all their money, they can't buy any more extra minutes. Ah! This ain't Verizon where you can buy a few. Come on, are you with me today? They can't buy any more extra minutes in a day than they already have. So this watchman has come here to tell you that for all of us, time is running out. Let me hurry. The second thing I found out in this scripture, the second warning, Revelation 12:12, is that not only do we have a short time, but life is short. Even for those who live long, trust me. Trust me, ask anybody in this church who is over, real old, like over 70. They will tell you life is short. The other day, I was in the grocery store, and I looked up the package of food. I was looking for the expiration date, and it dawned on me that all of us have an expiration date. I don't know when I will sing my last song. I don't know when I'll preach my last sermon. But for all of us, life is short. Someone said, at 10 years old, I couldn't wait to be a teenager. 13, I couldn't wait to get into high school. 15, I couldn't wait to drive. 18, I couldn't wait to go to college. 21, I couldn't wait to get married. 30, I couldn't wait to have my dream job. 40, I couldn't wait for the kids to be grown. 50, I couldn't wait for the blessing of grandkids. 60, I couldn't wait for retirement so I could start living on some of that money I paid into Social Security. And even though all my life I've been saying I can't wait for the next milestone, I have yet to hear anybody say I can't wait to grow old. All of a sudden, this church is quiet. Nobody says I can't wait to grow old. It was Woody Allen who said, it's not that I'm afraid to die, I just don't want to be around when it happens. Life is short. There's a story about three demons arguing over how best to destroy Christians. The first demon said, let's tell them there's no heaven. Take away their reward and their faith will collapse. The second demon disagreed and said, no, let's tell them there's no hell. Take away their fear of punishment and they'll all live crazy. They'll go wild. The third demon smiled and said, no, no, my friends, there's a better way. Let's just tell them there's no need to hurry. You have lots of time. That will ensure their destruction. According to the story, those demons agreed that would be the best weapon, because it doesn't matter how long you live. If you don't make your days count for God, you will waste your life. If you don't make your days count for God, you will waste your life. You've heard the expression, killing time. Life is short. You don't have time to waste. Every hour is precious. So use every day wisely. Someone said you may tie your shoes in the morning, and you never know, someone else may have to tie it for you at night. Because history is full of people who ran out of moments during the day they lived. So this watchman here today is coming to tell you just like I see it. Number one, Revelation 12:12 is telling you life is short. Time is running out. From a little boy, I memorized something, a little thing my mother used to say. Soon this life will be past, and only what's done for God will last. And believe me, I understand. You only have one life to live, and then it's over. Look at what James 4:14. Let's look at the scriptures. For what is your life? It is even a vapor that appeareth for a little while and then vanisheth away. And then Psalm 103, verse 15. As for man, his days are as grass, as a flower of the field. So he flourisheth, for the wind passeth over it, and it is gone. The place thereof shall know it no more. And Psalm 90, verse 9. For all our days are passed away in thy wrath. We spend our years as a tale that is told. Church, in the Bible, our lives are also compared to a wind that passes by. Can you imagine that? The wind that passes you. God says, that's your life. Psalm 78, verse 39. For he remembereth that they were but flesh, a wind that passeth away and cometh not again. And in this life, there are no cosmic do-overs. Live your best life. You don't have a chance to do it again. It is appointed, the Bible says, for man to die once, and after this comes the judgment. And finally, church, finally, this watchman came to tell you that not only is life short, not only is time running out, but the Bible tells us in Revelation 12:12 that the devil is angry. He's angry because he knows he has a short time. That's what it says. Therefore rejoice, you heavens, and you who dwell in the earth. Woe unto the earth and the sea, because the devil has come down to you. He is filled with fury, seething anger. He knows that his time is short. The devil is angry because he knows for him, time is running out. This watchman has come today just to do one thing, to sound an alarm that the enemy of our souls is angry because he knows he's running out of time. What do you think you are looking at when you look at the news? You are just looking at an angry devil. The devil knows. Look at what the servant of God says. Look at what she says. The wrath, my Jesus, help me preach this word. The wrath of Satan increases as his time grows short, and his work of deceit and destruction will reach its culmination in the time of trouble. We are living in a time when Satan is driven by the knowledge that the world is coming to an end, and he knows he's got just a little, Lord help us, a little time to work. And you better believe we are living in the days that our forefathers thought they would never see. We are alive to see those days prophesied in scripture. The days of darkness and wrath the Bible talks about, they are on us now. Wake up. That's what this watchman is shouting. Wake up. Life is short. Time is running out, and the devil is angry. The church of the living God is the focus of his wrath. The devil hates the church outside and inside. And when the Bible speaks of his wrath, it talks about his anger. The Bible tells us his days are numbered. He's angry because his days are numbered. And he knows it. He has but a short time. He knows he will only be, listen to me. The devil knows he will only be allowed to live as long as God allows him to live. Even his life comes from God. 1 Peter 5:8 says, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about, seeking whom he may devour. But Revelation 12:12 tells us, thank you, Jesus. He won't be roaring much longer. Hallelujah. He can only roar as long as God wants him to roar. Revelation 12:12 tells us that, praise the Lord, his power is already broken. Amen. It reminds us that his days are numbered. That makes him angry. That's why he can and he will try to take out that anger on you. He sees his power waning. He is angry. Some people, when they see power waning, come on now, they get angry. When his triumphs are waning, he gets angry. He's angry because when he overwhelms us with moods, let me tell you why the devil's really angry as I close. Pianist, go to the piano. When he overwhelms us with moods of discouragement, he knows it's just for a while, because Jesus loves us so much that when we call on his name, he sends the Holy Spirit to cheer us up. Oh, Lord have mercy. You know, when you're mad with somebody, you want them to be sad. But when something comes along and makes them happy, you get even more mad with what made them happy. Come on, are you with me today? Maybe it's never happened to you. It's happened to me all the time. Folks look at you, they're mad with you, and then you get blessed by God. You think that makes them happy? No, it makes them even more mad. He's mad because he sees when we are discouraged, Jesus sends the Holy Spirit to cheer us up, give us hope. In spite of our failures, he's angry because he knows when we are being defeated, Jesus reaches down and, come on somebody, and he lifts us up. He's angry because every time he knocks me down, Jesus comes along and picks me up. He's angry because everything in my DNA, everything in my family tree says that I was born in sin, shaping in iniquity, that the apple doesn't fall far from the tree. But he's angry because when I gave my life to Jesus, he gave me the power to walk in the light of his will and word. Behold, what manner of love that the Father has bestowed upon us, that we, come on, let me tell you why he's mad. Because he knows Jesus calls me. His son, that I should be called the Son of God. Beloved, now we the sons of God, it does not appear what we shall be, but he knows. He's mad. He's mad because he's read the scripture too. And he knows that when Jesus appears, I will be like him. So he mad. He's angry. Because people like you, people like me, who should be going nowhere, one day we'll live forever in glory. We will live where he was thrown out of. You don't think he's mad? Brothers and sisters, this watchman just came to tell you what I see and to warn. Your life is short. Time is running out. And the devil, he's angry. And that's where we are today. Will you pray with me? Father in heaven, I cannot worry about what others think. I have a responsibility that you've given to me to be a watchman, to watch and to warn. Father, I've delivered my soul today. I've told the people what you told me to tell them. And Revelation 12:12 reminds us that life is short. That time is running out. And that the enemy, the devil, he is angry. Lord, when we see places like Maui and we see fire and hurricane winds, we know demons are involved. The devil is angry. Because he knows that the Bible says that one day he will be cast into the lake of fire. And he's so angry he wants to take some of us with him. I just ask, dear God, today that you will keep us vigilant. Help us to see the enemy when he encroaches upon our lives. Father, thank you, Jesus. Thank you. And may not just me, but everyone in this church today see their calling to be watchmen, to tell it like we see it. And to warn. And to remind the world that God is at the helm of all current events. He rules still. He rules the drama of history. He has his own calendar, his own hour, his own day. And one day Jesus will say, enough. And when Jesus says, enough, time will run out. And then he will come. Thank you for this word from your throne today. Thank you for Revelation 12:12. And may we be faithful until the end. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You know, there's a hymn, he will come in the clouds of his Father's bright glory. And we what? No, not the hour. Let's stand and sing that hymn before we go today. We know not the hour of the Master's appearing. Oh, my Lord. Come on, let's sing it like we mean it and like we know it. Oh, thank you, Lord. Not the hour of the Master's appearing, yet signs all foretell that the moment is nearing when he shall return. Tis the promise most cheering, but we know. Gave me as I prepared for my message, to honor Christ, to become like him, to work for him, is the life's highest ambition and its greatest joy. Hallelujah! To honor Christ, to become like him, to work for him, is the life's highest ambition and its greatest joy. Amen. We'll watch and we'll pray.
We'll watch and we'll pray with our lamps trimmed and burning. We'll work and we'll wait till the Master's returning. We'll sing and rejoice every omen deserving, but we know not the hour.
We will come.
Oh Lord, let us watch and be ready. He will come. Hallelujah, hallelujah. He will come in the clouds of his Father's bright glory. But we know not the hour.
Let us bow our heads for the benediction today.
Father, we thank you, we praise you, we lift you up, we exalt your name because you are worthy to be praised. We thank you, Lord, for what we have heard. But Lord, we ask that you will give us the unction to obey. To obey, to receive, and to be ready. To be ready. We thank you. In your righteous name I pray. Amen. Amen.
Be blessed, my brother. Be blessed, my sister. Life to you.
shepherd. Jesus will guard his children. In his arms he carries them all day long. Praise him, tell of his excellent greatness. Praise him, ever in joyful song. Praise him, Jesus our blessed Redeemer. For our sins he suffered and bled and died. He our rock, our hope of eternal salvation. Hail him, hail him, Jesus the crucified. Sound his praises, Jesus who bore our sorrows. Love unbounded, wonderful, deep and strong. Praise him, tell of his excellent greatness. Praise him, ever in joyful song. Praise him, Jesus our blessed Redeemer. Heavenly waters, thou with hosannas ring.